IT Idiots would like to thank UK2.net for sponsoring the show, the UK's largest provider of web hosting, providing the content and bandwidth distribution for this show.
Right. Okay, welcome to episode 11 of IT Idiots. My name's Nicholas Hill, and joined as always by Nikki Curtis, who this week is just obviously a bit crazy with the heat and the summer and the football. I think you're just... You just lost it. Plus, you're working 7 days a week now, aren't you?
Yeah, so that's a bit depressing. But managed to get today off because I'm so efficient. And if anyone at work's watching this, you'll know this already. And I managed to get the job done in one day.
One whole day?
Yeah, I'm pretty good.
Okay, so does that mean the client gets charged less now, I would imagine?
I'm not only sure, but I think I should get paid more.
I should get paid more.
Well, what I really should have done is not finished on Saturday and made it last 2 days because I get double time on Sunday.
Well, you'll get paid anyway.
But no, it's not the money, it's obviously the passion, Eurodata.
That must be what it is. Yeah. Right, so we've got no Shabby Knackley this week.
No.
Last week we sold his camcorder, and the bidding was frenetic up until, basically there was no bidding right up until the last moment.
Well, it was at 1p for a little while, wasn't it?
Well, basically up until 47 minutes prior to. Then somebody came in at £1.20. And I guess what we'll do is we'll go to eBay and we will show you how popular this podcast is. This is how much people were willing to pay.
Well, I'll link from my main site. Obviously, it's quite a busy site with all the people, but... Oh, we managed to get on. That's lucky. It has crashed a few times, mate. You know that. But it is open source websites, if you want to say.
It hasn't crashed.
Right, Shabby's camera. How much did it actually go for?
£22,000,
which is... Not bad.
And that wasn't us manipulating it. That was just you guys out there just wanting to take part and to provide funding, I guess, for the show.
So that would be good, £22,000.
So I thank you, Lynn1P, for...
Have we actually got the money through on, or Shelby got the money through on that? I mean, I've checked out her feedback and she appears to be a new user, I think. She's recently created her account. She hasn't got any feedback, but...
She's going to get 100% feedback when she sends us £22,000.
I'm willing to give her some good feedback, and I hope you enjoyed the camera.
Yeah. So Shabby's off spending the money, which I'm sure she'll transfer, or he'll transfer very shortly. So thank you for that. So yeah, one lucky owner of a dodgy Sony camcorder. Anyway, so what have you been up to this week, apart from work? Anything? How are you getting with Parallels?
Parallels? Oh yeah, MacBook, as you probably guys saw last week. Got Parallels on it, running Windows 2003 server on it at the moment, and as soon as I installed it, I thought, what the hell am I doing to my Mac? You know, why are you
you're bastardising
it? What I'm trying to do is trying to get rid of PCs totally, because I'm a great Mac fan, and obviously I need to run server products and stuff for work, so it's looking good. I've got a gig of memory coming from Crucial in it.
Half a gig?
I've got a gig coming. Listen, man, I've got a gig coming, so maybe that would improve it a little bit. It's a little slow at the moment, but...
I was going to say, because was it giving over about 100 meg to Windows 2003 server?
172, I think, which is the...
172 meg, that's very good.
The highest you can give it under the recommended allowance, I think. We're getting boring already, aren't we?
I think we are.
Parallels, what else? Nothing. What about you, Nick? I never asked you what you've done, because I don't assume you've done anything interesting.
Thanks, mate. How have I been up to? No, I've been looking at possibly buying a new laptop. Been looking at...
It's by Sony.
Well, I've been looking at a number of brands... But it's just the Sony make good laptops. There's just
evil company.
Nobody's making. Well, now we're never going to get sponsorship from them.
They weren't sponsored by Sony. They can go to hell. I wouldn't want them branding our site. Not at all. Go away.
So, I'm just looking at a number of brands, but I'd like something powerful, something maybe with a couple of gig of RAM and just At least keep me going for another 6 months till something new comes out. Anyway, so what are we going to look at this week, Nikki? Let's get back to doing something techie-based.
Well, we had one guy who left some feedback about wanting to do something about TCP/IP ports.
Oh, months ago.
Months ago. And because, yet again, we haven't done any preparation, really thought about what we're going to do, we thought we'd base it around that recommendation. So I hope it goes well. I've got to admit, I'm certainly not an expert in sort of networking, so I know... You know, we've got some really techie networking people watching this, so I'm not going to go delve down into areas which I don't know about.
Okay.
But I think for most people, my knowledge would be a lot greater than yours. So
what are we actually doing? What are we actually doing?
Well, I said ports.
Well, ports, is that as in harbours, or...?
Well, you need to watch the episode.
Oh, okay.
I'm bored already.
right, okay, ports.
Right, so I've got a little notepad here. So what does it say? Ports clear up, show network monitor. Right, what we're going to have a look at is ports. So let's start with a little bit on paint and just set the scene. All right, where are you, paint? So I suppose this is a podcast which follows, more than follows our TCP/IP episode. It's like part two of the TCP/IP episode. So what we're going to have a look at first is, let's just say we've got our one network here, the laptop machine, which I'm currently running paint on here, so it's quite a powerful laptop. It can do paint and screen capture. And we've got Nick's laptop, which is also connected to the network. And come on, Pam. And it's actually doing the video capturing over there at the moment.
And running a servers, and that's what a Sony product will do for you. But anyway, yeah.
Yeah, so what we want to do is, just a way of describing ports, what Nick's running on his laptop, he's running a web server. So a web server, we normally refer to as HTTPD.
I'm running Apache web server.
Yeah, so with TCP/IP applications, a lot of them, there's a client and server process. The client process for a web server, or the client application is Internet Explorer or Firefox or whatever you choose. The web server could be Apache. Is it Apache?
It is.
Apache Internet Explorer, IIS.
Internet Information Server.
IIS.
I've got it on there, but I just don't run it.
Don't choose to run it.
Comes from an evil corporation.
They're not so bad now. I think they're in the corner now. I hate saying that, so I'm sticking up for them, but they are getting a bit more friendly.
And
their apps are getting a bit better as well.
I'd sell that bloody Apple thing, because it was rubbish yesterday when you tried to use real-time. Couldn't watch anything on it.
My Apple's great. Right, so the D at the end, it stands for daemon. So that's an HTTPD, and daemon is like the server process. Your FTP client could be, what do you use? Smart FTP?
I use a couple, yeah.
WSFTP, that could be your client. The server would be called FTPD daemon. So daemon, like demons.
I use CyberDuck on my Mac.
Yeah, I use CyberDuck as well, yeah.
Only because it comes with a cute
and it's
icon.
Universal binary
it's
as well.
Universal binary.
Yeah, so daemon. Guardian angel in Greek, I think it's what it sounds, what it is. Right, so he's running a web server on there. Now, how are we going to put ports into this? Well, a web server, when you communicate with a web server, your traffic is targeted against port 80. Mm-hmm. So Nick's laptop up on there. What he's got is I call it a listener, and I'm not going to be able to write port 80 in there, am I? So let's just draw an arrow and just say he's listening to port 80 at the moment. He's got a listener on that. So if I load up Internet Explorer here on my machine, i.e.
Mm-hmm.
Bloody... When I load up Internet Explorer and go to his laptop, my network traffic would be coming from a particular port, but it'd be directed at his port 80. So we'll have a look at that network monitor in just a second. But from the previous podcast, you should be aware also it'd be stamped with my source IP address mm-hmm. and his destination IP address. But if you think about the traffic I'm going to send to Nick, just saying, it's from my IP address, it's to you, there's not enough information as to what I'm trying to access on his machine. So really what I access is his IP and his port to access the service. So I'll be accessing his IP address on port 80. Likewise, if he was running, you're not likely to do this, but if he was running a mail server, he'd be listening to port 25 on that. Telnet is port 23. You know, FTP is port 21. So he can be running all of these services on one IP address. And if I want to communicate with his FTP server, I go to port, you know, his IP colon port 20 and 21. It's actually just a couple of ports. If I want to Telnet, I go to port 23. But you're listening to port 80.
What's this on port 8080?
Port 8080. It's a familiar one. I think lots of our proxy servers used to use 8080. Did your ISA server use proxy 8080? Yeah. So I don't think it's lots of people use 8080, but there's also another one. I think it's 3268. I don't know.
Who cares?
Now, what port am I going to use? Now, this really sort of important to just basic TCP/IP communication, because when I communicate with Nick, I'm going to be using a from port, but I'll be going to his port. So the port I come from will be anything, it'll be a randomized port, high in 1023. Mm-hmm. So if I communicate to him, I could be saying from port 2000 to his port 80. And when he replies back, he'll be going from his port 80 to my port 2000.
Yeah.
Because remember, I might be communicating with another web server. Mm-hmm. So I could be using port 3000 to that web server and port 2000 to you.
Correct.
And when I get the traffic back,
distinguish.
Well, you could think about it this way. I need to know what Internet Explorer window to filter it down into. You know, I say, well, port 2000 is going into, I can't remember now, port 3000 is going to this site. Okay, so let's have a look at that network monitor. And network monitor, it's just a network, well, it's a protocol analyzer. It lets me find out what's going on in the network. So if I just run it and go to Nick's laptop machine, we should be able to see what traffic is flying around. Now, you can use, there's plenty of public domain ones or shareware ones out there. Ethereal is a pretty good one.
Okay.
That's quite a good one. But as I'm a Microsoft guy, let's click on start. Let's capture. So we're capturing now. I'm going to load up Internet Explorer or Firefox in this case.
Does it make a difference?
Not really, no. And once I've selected all, come on. I don't suppose you know the IP of your machine, do you, Nick? Oh, yes, we do. 192.168.168.1.101. So hit return.
Ah, no, because I rebooted connect. My machine, so it might have given me a one. You might have taken.
Yeah, you might have got a
102 or 103.
Okay, so it's got a 102 address. I think 101 must be my Mac. Or my DS or something like that. So that looks like a good website, Nick.
Gorgeous.
You can tell you're a web developer.
It's nice and clean.
Yep, nice and clean. Anyway, we should stop this capture, actually. So if I stop the capture, we can see a lot of stuff has gone on in the network. And the way to have a look at this is we can see this is the source machine it's going to, and that's the destination machine it's going to. Now, this is looking at something we haven't talked about before called MAC addresses.
Mm-hmm.
Now, every machine, well, Nick's got an IP address, I've got an IP address.
But that would be a PC address, not a Mac address.
That would, yeah, so it's like a bit like a software address. Oh, God, I just got that. So Mac, nothing to do with Apple Mac, Media Access Control is what it stands for.
Oh, yes.
Physical address, physical it could address. Be something like that. But every network card has got a different Mac address, so mm-hmm. they're totally unique. Now, network monitors being a little bit friendly for us, what it's doing, instead of showing my Mac address, it's got local. But destination Mac address we can see. I'm talking to 572, not quite know what that is. In actual fact, I know what that is, that's my router.
Yeah.
And if we just trace down, we should be able to see me going to Nick's machine. In actual fact, let's look at this packet here, the first one. What we can see, this is an ARP broadcast, and what it's trying to do is it's trying to find out the MAC address for a machine whose IP is 192.168.1.100.
Mm-hmm.
We can then see there's another ARP one there. It's asking for the IP address 19. It's asking for the MAC address 192.168.1.101. Now that was probably when I went into Firefox and typed in HTTP 192.168.1.101, because we can't send that packet out on the network because there's not enough. We can't address to an IP address.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be addressed to a physical address, a MAC address. Okay,
so it's got to go and bind that.
Yeah, basically what happens is if I want to talk to 192.168.1.101. This is me shouting out to it, and I want its MAC address.
Mm.
Once I get its MAC address, I can put that on the start of the packet, and that becomes, if you like, the address, the carrier of that packet, to the next router or the destination. So ARP is really involved with getting to the next step, because mm-hmm. it's broadcast-based. And then we can see there is no response on that.
But that's because 101 wasn't my machine.
Yeah, and you're 102. So yeah. It looks like this is the start of the communication, we can see. And this is me doing a broadcast. So I'm shouting out on my network. I want to know the IP. I want to know the MAC address of someone with the IP 192.168.1.102. And we can see next off packet, we get an IP. We get a reply from this MAC address to me, and it's a response to that ARP, Address Resolution Protocol, and it's saying, look, I own 192.168.1.103, and this is my MAC address. Okay, so we can see that's the MAC address.
Yeah.
So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to communicate with his web server. Now, there's lots of traffic I'm showing on here, and just to simplify it a little bit, I'm just going to filter and say, just show me HTTP traffic. And again, I'm using this tool just to demonstrate. There's no, you don't need to know to use it, because you can use Ethereal. They all do exactly the same, pretty much.
I would think it's something that's fairly self-explanatory when you play around with it.
Yeah, you just need to play around these things, yeah. So let's enable HTTP.
That's going to refilter all
it's
of that.
It's going to refilter,
there
yeah.
There you go. That's so, a lot cleaner, isn't it?
A lot cleaner. Now, we really should have noted your MAC address. I don't know what your MAC address was, but I'm guessing it's that 3E10, because there's lots of communication going on between there, isn't
yep.
there?
Lots from what I can remember, I think it is 3E10 that it finishes yeah. with my MAC address.
So let's have a look at the original GET request. So this is me sending out to that MAC address, and it's a GET request.
Yep.
So what am I getting? I'm asking for... Oh, no, this is me actually loading out Firefox. It's going to the internet. It's going to www.google.co.uk. But it's quite interesting what you can see here, because we can see the information. It's actually encapsulated as it flies on the network. Right, let's get some paint going. Oh, I might try and attempt to do an OSI model.
Wow.
I don't know if I can hold that one together, though. Right, so what happens? My machine... Well, let's concentrate on the Google one, I think.
Yeah,
let's
that's
forget
fine.
About your machine. Because it's a Sony.
Oh.
And what Firefox did is it sent out its HTTP GET requests. So we can just see GETs like that. Actually, we can... Actually, you full screen this now, Nick, don't you?
Yeah.
That's fine. Now, the next thing we've got is that is encapsulated. So if I look at this, it's encapsulated by a TCP header. Now, TCP is to do with the ports. So in here, what you'll see is the port I'm using. Now, I don't know what port I'm going to be using, but it's going to be 1023. So the source port, I'm going to put this up here because I think this is good stuff. Let's say it could be 2000. The destination port... will definitely be what?
80.
Definitely be port 80. And all of that information is held in that part. The next thing it needs to do, so that describes where the services we're accessing, is the IP address. So TCP header, IP header is next. So in that, what we'll see is the source IP. Oh God, this is all going wrong. And the destination IP.
Yeah.
So the source IP would be my IP address, the destination IP would be yours. But as we said before, we can't use that information to communicate on the network. There's not enough information there. We need to target the physical address of his network card.
Yeah.
So that, again, is encapsulated.
And gets tagged on.
Tagged on with the MAC header.
Yeah.
And that will have the source MAC and destination MAC address.
So we've built up an entire... packet of information.
Exactly, yeah. Now, obviously the headers are nowhere, that's not drawn to scale at all, and that the data field in there, the nice thing about that is if you were writing a web browser or a web browser or web server, you don't need to care about the network part, and that's all standardized. All you need to do is be able to communicate between those two layers.
Yep.
Those two layers there. That's all you need to do.
Yep.
Okay. So we can actually have a look at that. Now, it's a little bit geeky, but if we load up Network Monitor and just, I can use the mouse now, can I? And just have a look at the data frame. I call it a data frame. Again, I'm not so sure if I'm using the right terminology, but you Cisco guys can correct me on that. But we can have a look at what we're getting. And we can see the source is Mozilla 5. So I'm using a Mozilla 5 browser, which is Firefox. And I can't actually see the GET request in that one. Yeah, there we go. Google.co.uk.
Yeah.
And then we can see this machine here, who's replying to me, and it probably is... the actual Google
peeps.
Google page. Now again, you can see I'm looking at the bottom. That's just the data frame. I can't read that.
I've translated it. It looks roughly like the Google page.
Yeah, let's have a quick.
Yeah.
That looks like the Google homepage. So that's replying back to me. Now, what's that MAC address, Nick? Now this is a real key point. Now I haven't described this, but let's see if you can get this. The MAC address it's coming from. What do you think that MAC address is? Is it the MAC address of the Google web server?
It's probably not actually.
You're right. It's not. What could it be?
There.
It's the router. Yeah, it's actually the router. Yeah, so
the big mate, I was pointing to our big server rooms and behind the closed doors yeah, with all our powerful hardware that's sat in there.
My rack mounted unit over there, which is just
gorgeous.
Mounted above the Xbox, isn't that? So what's my point? Yeah, so MAC address. So the IP, when I communicated across to Google, the IP part of the frame. We're going to have to do a little bit of pretending here, guys. So I actually did use NAT here, but let's pretend that didn't happen. I had a real IP address, because you know that. The IP part of that frame, this bit here, didn't change. Okay, the source and destination IP were exactly the same. It always came from me, and it always went to Google. This bit here always remained the same.
But your router intercepted it.
But the MAC address is the one that's changing every network it hops to. Because when I'm communicating with Google, what I do is I advertise for the next address, the next hop, which is my router.
Yeah.
That router, if you like, will, again, broadcast for its next hop. And the MAC header will be replaced all the time.
Sure.
Pretty sure that's right, anyway.
I think you're right, I'm
pretty sure that's correct. Now, also, I suppose we could tie a little bit of firewalls into this. You know, Nick, if you don't want me accessing your web server anymore.
It's you could liberty, just... that is. How dare you look at my web server?
Well, I'm not actually convinced that I did. But what Nick could do is he could put a block on that port. So when you guys are in your Windows XP firewall, you can put a block on port 80, and that way people can't get to your web server. Mm-hmm. I think remote desktop, off the top of my head, I think remote desktop is 3.2.6.8. Do you recall that?
I think
it's 3.2.6.8, but let's pretend it is 3.2.6.8. If Nick wants to stop me getting to remote desktop, or in actual fact, it would stop everyone.
Yeah.
He could put a block on port 3.2.6.8 as well. So that's basically how your firewalls work. So, is that exciting?
It's gorgeous.
Okay, what's next on my list? Web request to Nick, diagram serve with multiple services. I think we covered that, didn't we? So if you've got multiple services, you've got different ports. Private versus public addressing. That's sort of important, I suppose.
Yeah.
Right, now, source and destination address on a network, they need to be unique. It's got to be totally unique. Now, when I communicated to Google, I had my source address stamped on it, so Google needed to get back to that source address. Mm-hmm. Obviously, when Google replying, it becomes the Google destination address. Mm-hmm. So the IP address I came from has got to be routable. Mm-hmm. Now, if I had a real IP address or a public IP address, no problem, they're routable. But I don't. Neither do you. Neither do lots of people. Neither do you, probably. I've got a private address.
Yeah.
Now, the private address on my machine is ipconfig. Let's have a look. I've got a bit of problems with my laptop at the moment, but can't bother that.
I think yours was 104.
I think mine's 104. So the IP address of my machine is 192.168, which is a private IP range. Now, let's just load up a bit of notepad on this.
Thank God for that, otherwise we're going to run out of IP addresses on the internet.
Yeah. If you think about it, an IP address, if you look at it from the IP addressing lesson we did, or whatever you want to call it, we learned it was 32 bits. So there's obviously only a finite amount of them, and think of the amount of people on the internet now.
It's a huge amount.
There's loads of people. I know at least three or four.
They're coming online daily.
All the it's getting a catch on, I think.
I think it is.
This internet business. But there's loads of them. So why haven't we run out of IP addresses? Well, in actual fact, I could have
at least five or six in this room.
I've got about six machines all accessing the internet, all with a private IP address. Now, that private IP address is non-routable.
Yeah.
So when I send out to Google, my source address is 192.168.1.whatever.
It's translated.
When Google replied, let's not get there yet.
Okay.
If Google replied to that, they'd be replying to 192.168.1. Now, they don't know how to get that.
Well, they'll probably get back to their own machine.
Well, so why am I loading up?
Because we're doing public versus private versus...
I'm just going to load up a notepad because I just want to write some numbers down. I'm capturing at 25 frames a second because Nick's quite inept at video editing and he's losing sync all the time, as you probably noticed. I have nothing to do with the pre-production work. I'm just the sort of quality content, and Nick sort of bastardizes that.
I think it just shows through, no matter how hard I work on it, it always comes down to the quality of the material you're producing.
So if you take the IP range 192.168, don't care what the last bit is, 00, that's private, that's non-routable, doesn't exist on the internet.
Nope.
So I'm using 192.168.1, you're using 1, lots of people are using 1, aren't they? Because it's default. You could use 5, you could use 200, it's up to you. Right, another private range, lots of corporates use this, is 10.0.0.0/8, which basically means the last three octets can be used by that organisation. Whereas, we've got 192.168.1, we've only got 255 or 254 machines on that. They've got shed loads of them. So if you're working in a corporate network, you've probably got a 10... Now, you might have a 192. There's also a 172.16 with a bit of a strange subnet mask. Right, what's my point? Private versus public addressing. Right, now what Nick was trying to say is, what Nick did actually say was NAT, network address translation. What happened when I accessed Google is my router's doing, my router's doing something called network address translation. Now, many people, you guys have probably got wireless routers or some kind of router that lets you have multiple devices on your home network. And what actually happens is as those devices communicate to the internet, the source address gets modified on the router.
Mm-hmm.
And on the router, it changes the source address from, in my case, 192.168.1.1 to a real IP address that the router's got, in my case, off my ISP, TeleWest. Okay.
Is that static or...?
It's actually dynamic.
It's dynamic, yeah.
So it changes to that. So when that goes to Google, who are Google replying to? They're replying to my router.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing is, what does my router then do?
The router's then got to work out who requested that.
Exactly. It's got to go back to me. Now, remember, Nick could be accessing Google on his laptop, his Sony Evo laptop.
I was accessing a lot worse earlier on.
You were accessing Google. So he could be using Google. I could be using Google all through the same IP address.
How's that work? It's amazing.
And again, it's all down to ports.
Ports.
It's all down to ports. So I'm going to attempt to draw a diagram here. I'll show you my router. Show how this all really works.
If it involves a diagram, embedded lots of description with it.
Yeah, the trouble with...
Your drawing.
Well, it's paint in this graphics tablet.
You bought it.
We really want a budget here, aren't we? We've got our camera's £150. How much is this? £10?
No, it was about 40 quid.
40 quid. Well, we're sponsored. Yeah. We're still sponsored, aren't we?
Yeah, I think. Oh, we apologised last week if your computer was attempting to download the show and there was nothing to download. Whilst I was uploading it, Nikki decided to just make the XML available, regardless of the fact that data wasn't actually there to start downloading. So it was Nikki's fault.
What day was that? Was that Tuesday?
I think it was.
What time do we normally have the episodes uploaded by and complete by Monday? So we're already sort of one day behind schedule, weren't we?
Yeah, but it all comes down to the incompetencies of coming around here and actually being able to film something, given all my production time that's required. You guys put enormous strains on me. What was that?
That's the network.
It's got a kink in it.
It's got a kink.
You'll be able to straighten that cable out, you know?
It'll go quicker. Faster throughput. Yeah. Okay, so here's my laptop on the network. Let's put the little router.
It's a huge router.
Up here. Oh, sorry, a router, if you guys want to redefine English.
It's going to, your network's going downhill as well.
It is. Right, so that's obviously yours next, Sony. Right, now...
Euphemism for a sinking ship.
That's going off to this cloudy thing here, which is the Tinternet. Oh.
T.
I assume you guys know Peter Kay. I don't know if America, Peter Kay's big in America.
I have no idea.
Who cares?
He's big everywhere. Right,
so my IP address over here is... I'm going to make it up. 192.168.1.1. The router's got a real IP address. Again, I'm going to make this up. I haven't got a clue what it is. 83.107.2.1. And we've got Google over here, who's got another IP address. So I'm going to say, again, just totally making it up, 110.3.2.1. Right, so what actually happened there, when I goes to Google, my source address, it first of all starts with 192.168.1.1. Mm-hmm. And let's say my destination port is 2000. So let's do a bit of notepad on this. So this is from 192.168.1.1, and I'm going to say port 2000. And where's it going to? It's going to...
What, it's going to 10.3.2.
Wouldn't be 10, would it? Because that would be public.
I assumed you'd already done a 1.
Don't assume anything.
Port 80.
Port 80. Now, normally that wouldn't get modified, you know, and it's path going to Google and it's path coming back again. But obviously we know Google is going to have a little bit of an issue routing back to 192.168.1.1. It won't be able to because it's non-recognisable. So what the router actually does is it will modify the source address and it will say, you know what, it's not from 192.168.1.1. It's from 83.107.2.1. What port is it going to use?
Why is there a colon between the 83 and the 107? Is that like a special sort of identifying type?
What colon?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's coming from 83.107.2.1.
Yeah.
And it's going to choose a port.
I was going to say, it's going to have to make one up.
It will make one up. So 3000, we've seen this one. Where's it going to? So this is NAT, and remember the IP header doesn't normally change. it's going to 110. .3.2.1:80.
That's very good.
Right, now what that router is going to remember now, it's going to remember, it's got a, if you like, port mapping table. It knows that if it gets a response to port 3000,
that's you.
That's me, the laptop. Okay, so let's just write this down in sort of like Mickey Mouse talk. I'm going to remember that incoming 3000 traffic is for, No, it needs to know the port as well.
Of course it does.
And that's basically that. So you can see, what happens now. So when it goes to Google, it's going to Google 83.107.2.1, and it's going to Google at 110.3.2.1, and it's coming from my router. So Google actually thinks that I'm talking to, that my router's talking to them. So if you look at the stats, you'll see 83 be registered on Google.
Yeah.
And when Google replies back, it replies back to Google's IP address.
It replies back to my router address.
So the original packet comes back from Google, so let's say from Google. And that is from, what is it?
110.3.2.1.
2.1 port
80.
Port 80. And it's going to...
Was there?
83.
107.
I'm trying to be a bit interactive.
So you want me to get involved as well. I have to edit it. I have to be like everything. Wow. That's great.
Right, okay, so it's going going to... And that's my router. Now, my router knows... Well, what does my router know?
It says, remember,
the incoming traffic to port 3000 is really for 192.168.1.2000. So what NAT will do...
It'll translate that.
And that modifies... the destination.
So it edits the packet.
The two box. I'm going to call it field again. I think. So if it comes from 110.3.2.1.80. And it's going to
192.168.1.1. Port 2000.
That's it.
And it's back at you, and that's it. It's such a simple concept, and yet people just don't seem to be able to get their heads around it.
No, it's as simple as that. Now, so to this machine, it's this laptop here is on the network, and actually sitting behind that does give me some benefits.
It protects you.
Yeah, because if you guys were to ping 192.168.1, come on, bring it on and attack me. What am I looking over there for? I'm looking at the router. But yeah, try and ping 192.168.1.1. It's not going to be me.
We'll even give them a tip. If you want to attack it, it's over there.
Yeah.
We even told them where to go and look.
So, that's it.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
It's not bad. So, smoking going well for you still, obviously. We just had an edit point. I see you're on your fag. So these things are quite addictive, I take it. Are you regretting this at all? Are you getting this? Are you still recommending that? Try it up. So I noticed this morning you were hacking up loads of shite in the...
Oh, it was the Mank.
What does Clive say? Hacking out the Mank? Mm. We always get Clive on Skype, I think. Anyway, let me carry on.
Yeah, I'm going to finish my cigarette.
Well, I can carry on.
Yeah, but I can't smoke. I can smoke in the social, in the casual one. But
stop it out.
Sorry. You know, so you were able to smoke whilst I was doing all the work. Cunt.
Right. Ready?
Ready.
Ready.
Okay, where were we? So that was Nat, then, basically.
That was Nat, yeah. What we were doing. Can't remember.
It was going to culminate. We're going to culminate.
Yeah,
this
we're going to culminate in
the crescendo of
something exciting. Something greatness. Unfortunately, while that was happening, it was changing the tape. So I hope you've enjoyed this week. And
no, so seriously.
Okay, all right. Let's get back on to it. Yeah, what we're going to look at now is reverse NAT port mapping. I've heard people call it so many different things, but basically. What we're trying to achieve is, I've got this machine, my laptop. Nick's got his laptop over there, his Sony Evil one. He's running a web server. Now, I want people to be able to access his web server from the internet.
Sounds reasonable.
Yeah, but the trouble with that is, his IP address is private. It's 192.168.1.103. So if you try and ping it now, you certainly won't be pinging Nick's machine. Yeah. So the only hope in hell chance I've got in you accessing his machine is I know my router's got a real address. So what I could do is... I could map it, because if I tell you to go to... I tell you there's a web server on the IP address of my router, we know one thing, you're going to go to port 80 on the router. So I could tell my router that if it has any incoming request to port 80, then it should forward it to 192.168.1. Whatever.
And if you do it in the next 20 minutes, you too will be able to download the latest episodes of... I don't know what I've got on there actually at the moment.
So what we've got is this network.
What, the downhill? Oh no, it's going uphill again.
Nice.
We
put the servers up there, yeah, and that way they've got...
It makes the data flows quicker. The data flows a bit quicker downhill.
Also, when you have networks like that, you've got to make sure that, you know, the terminator on here is extra thick.
Oh, okay, because it's travelling extra fast.
Momentum issues, yeah, down that hill. Right. So what we've got is... router. It's got an address. I'm going to attempt to write it out. 83.1.2.1. Good at single digits. Space issues. Nick's laptop is down here. Now, in actual fact, people at work, my work are trying to do this at the moment. Now, this web server, this could be any service that you want to make accessible from the internet. All you need to do is find the port that service is operating on and map that port. So I'm pretty sure that RDP, remote desktop for Windows XP, is 3.2.6.8, but you guys can check that out. And so if we're running, you know, remote desktop on that, let's put RD on that. And if we're running Nick's web server on that one, all we need to do is find out the IP address of this. So let's say that's 192.168.1.1. Mm-hmm. Sorry, 1.10.
10.
Because my router's actually 1. And this one here running remote desktop. Excuse me.
You can't do that. I'm going to have to beep that out.
Is going to be 192.168.1.11. Obviously one higher than you.
Okay.
So what I can now do is publish that IP address 83.1.2.1 and say, you know what, if you go to that, mm-hmm. you can RDP to my machine or you can access the web server.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously what we've got to do is two port mappings on that router, and we've got to say, if you're accessing port... Oh, that's trying to be a listener, but... Port 80 on that,
yeah.
Then I'm just going to draw some lines, I think, redirect to that. And it just does that by modifying the destination address of that router, other than that server. And if you're accessing port 3.2.6.8, then we should go down to that machine there.
Gotcha.
Okay. So what I've got is, I mean, I'm not in the office now, in our sort of large mass scale office, which is going really, really well. And
it's huge.
It's huge. I was actually getting quite depressed at lack of growth, but...
Yeah, well...
But hey, what was my point? Yeah, I'm not on my network. So much like lots of people, you guys maybe, is we got a router, or yeah. I've got a router connecting me out to the internet. And what I'm going to do is just have a look at that router. Now, I'm also going to give away my public IP address on when I do this. I don't know. Do you reckon people are going to be nasty enough to attack me?
Well, if you ask them to. Nah, you'll be fine.
I think, you know, people are nice enough, I think. Well, podcast people, I think, are generally quite friendly, aren't they?
They're lovely people.
So that's what I'm basing my security on. And you're friendly.
Anyone with any hacking talent isn't going to watch this podcast.
Nah. I'm going to give them one go.
I challenge them.
So I'm running a little Netgear router, and I'm just going to just scroll past. You can see I've got an internet IP address there. 83. Well, I don't want to read that, because I might get you to blur that. I'm not sure.
No, I'm going to blow it up right. And put it as a challenge at the end. Yeah, this week's homework, DOS this.
Let's see what happens anyway. Okay, so that's my IP address. Now, on the left-hand side of the screen, now obviously your router is going to be different to this, probably a cheaper one, I imagine. And we can go to port forwarding, port triggering. Oh, look, I've already got some port forward shit.
It shows real world.
It does, doesn't it? So you can see on mine, this is actually quite interesting. If you access my public IP address and come to port 6881, it's going to redirect that to a machine 192.168.1.151, which is a machine that's running something called Azurius.
I don't know what that is.
I'm not quite sure.
Obviously, one of your clients obviously just requested it.
Yeah, it's going down to 151. And we've got RDP, so did I say 3389?
I think you said
3289.
Yeah, something completely different.
Well, okay, so we can see RDP is, if you access the public IP address on 3389, it's going to redirect it to 192.168.1.100.3389, which I believe is my desktop machine, which is also running something called uTorrent.
I don't know what that is. Well, what's the benefit of setting this up on your router?
What, for torrenting?
Yeah.
They go quicker. Yeah. So
give people some information that they can actually take away and use in real world situations.
When you're torrenting, I mean, we torrent Twit, This Week in Technology. Yeah. It's I think you can get some dubious stuff on. Not dubious as in yeah, there's illegal stuff later in torrent. We're not condoning that at all.
Not at all. But it has legitimate purposes.
It does have legitimate purposes, yeah. And you can see I'm using on two machines. To have a look at it. But opening up the ports, I'm not quite sure. I'm not really a torrent expert.
No, I don't know anything about it.
Not at all. I don't know what it is. It does seem to make it go quicker.
Okay. That's the theory of it.
That's the thing.
But you're just implementing it to try stuff out. And
exactly.
As you say, to download
down complete, Twit.
Yeah, download Twit.
And okay, so anyway, I suppose we better go back to this diagram because I forgot what we're trying to do. We're trying to get down to Nick's machine. He's running 192.168.1.10 and he's got a web server. So on my router, what I can do is say, I'm going to add a service. And I'm going to say the service name of this is HTTP. It probably was defined anyway on this machine.
Mm-hmm.
Now HTTP uses TCP, not UDP. Two different sort of connection types.
They are.
TCP is connection orientated and UDP is connection less. So basic analogies, if I'm communicating TCP IP to you, it's like me phoning you up. We generate a connection and we talk over that connection and we're constantly saying, yeah, are you getting that, over and out, that kind of thing. With UDP, over Charlie, ticket. No, that's not good. Okay, with UDP, it's very similar to me writing on a postcard, popping in the post, I hope it gets there. But there's no guarantee. Of course, the application could send back.
Well, that'd be a little bit like a Father's Day card, wouldn't it?
Shit, man. it's 18th of June. Oh, I've got to get...
Yeah.
But I have been working all day. Okay, you're using port 80, aren't you?
I'm using port 80.
And editing port is port 80.
Yeah.
And
I'm going to send... 102, wasn't it?
2102. Oh, well, service is already in use. Can't use it more than twice. Let's have a look at that.
This would be Nicky's preparation then, would it?
So as you can see, we've already got HTTP service in there. So, you know, I could just simply add it in here. 101. Add.
102.
Was it 102? I can't even bother to remember anymore. You know? So we can see that. I think the problem was I added it and I called it HTTP. But it was already in there. It'd be interesting to see if RDP's in here. Yeah, RDP's actually in here as well.
Oh, okay.
So that's really it. So now if you access my public IP address and access port 3389, you'll be going to the RDP server 192.168.1.100. If Azurus, whatever, I'm not quite sure that is. If you access my web server, if you access my public IP address on port 80,
you'd get my
wonderful
web server.
It's great. I suppose the only other trouble is, I know this podcast is going on a little bit.
No, it's good. I'm enjoying it.
Let's just finish off a little bit. The only trouble is, if you guys are, you know, working around and you're trying to get access to your machine or from work or something from the internet cafe, the IP address on lots of people's home connection that actually changes. It's a DHCP address, and you guys should know that, what DHCP is, which means that tomorrow my IP address might change.
Yeah,
in which
the lease will expire, you'll get a new one.
In actual fact, they don't change that much. Yeah. It depends on who you use, but yeah. I mean, your router's on all the time, so it normally renews. But you definitely can't guarantee that that's going to stay the same. Now, some ISPs offer static IP addresses.
But you have to pay for that, and that's money down the drain, isn't it, a little bit?
You often got to pay for it, yeah. So, you know, what you can use, and lots of routers actually support this, is dynamic DNS. So this is actually built into my router, is something called a dynamic DNS client. Now if we go to this other website, if you want to always make sure that you can get to your machine via a name rather than an IP address. And if you, let's say if your IP address changes, that name is updated, i.e. it's dynamic. What you can do is go to this company, dyndns.org, or organization, and I won't bore you with it, but they will enable you to create a name, so we could be called something like itidiots. I don't know.
Blah, blah, blah.
Blah, blah, blah. And
it will map, basically, that name.
It'll map that name to your public IP address. And what you've got to do then is you go to your router, you tell it what your dynamic DNS username and password is. And every time your router gets a new IP address, it will automatically register with DynDNS.
Because in the early days, didn't you used to have to run a little utility that was sitting on your computer that would...
That's exactly right. Now, you know, I'm not sure for all routers now, but I'm sure people out there, maybe your router won't support this. My first router didn't support this. And what you can do is you can download it. It's all available on this site. You can download a little client and actually run it on one of your machines.
Yeah. Okay. It'll just periodically update those details for you. But it's a useful way of being able to make sure that you're always maxing out your download capabilities at home. Was it Clive says?
Yeah, if you're not using all your bandwidth, your ISP is steaming from you. So you've got to get your money's worth.
Exactly. So from work, obviously, constantly stay on top of your machine.
Okay, my router's down. I can't log on. Oh, I can log on. But I think that's probably about it.
I would say so.
That was a good wrap-up. So yeah. we had... it wasn't really all about ports, really. It was all. I think there was a lot of ports in there. So we saw source destination ports. We looked at network address translation. So how, you know, you can go from an address which isn't recognized by Google... how that, you know, traffic goes to and from. So we had a look at that. Publishing a service on a private IP address and making that available to someone on a public network, i.e. the internet.
Very useful.
And as I say, it's great with NAT because Nick's web server over there on Sony is secure. You can only get to port 80 on that machine. That's the only thing that's going to get mapped back.
Beautiful.
I mean, well, it's Sony, so it's as secure as perhaps possible, and it's running Windows as well.
Terrible.
So that's it.
Are you going to stop slagging things off now? Because I'm just...
I have a bit of an argumentative mood today.
You are, aren't you?
I don't know what it is. Too much work.
Got to be what it is. So, there we go. We did that episode on behalf of somebody who requested it. If you didn't like it and thought it was a waste of our time and your bandwidth, then why don't you write in and suggest something that we do a show on? Otherwise, next week we'll think of something. I don't know what we're going to do next week.
No, but, I don't know what we're going to do. I think we've got another 2 weeks of... sort of hectic episodes, haven't we?
Yeah, I'm trying to sort of fit things in around our busy schedules.
And after that, hopefully, I think things will...
Yeah.
We'll try and pick up on a topic. I mean, we don't really know where we're going on this, do we?
We don't. I mean, I think we might soon pick up on and do a big topic.
We could do a big topic. I mean, we could do a big...
Something sexy.
Well, I mean, I work in the corporate field, and I could do Exchange Server, SMS, Proxy Server, so I can do those. I'm not sure if you want to hear that, though. Or we could concentrate on home networking stuff, a bit like what we've done today. Or, you know, anything, really. I don't mind, it's just...
We'll figure it out as we go along.
But, right.
Okay, I think on that note, we'll wrap it up.
Okay.
Cheers, guys.
IT Idiots is sponsored by UK2.net, the UK's largest web hosting provider. With domains from just £1.99 and web hosting from just 40p a day, visit itidiots.uk2.net for weekly offers. Get your piece of the internet at uk2.net.
Well, that was himself to sleep tonight on a huge pillow.